again to my channel English Made Easy with Mandeep. And today I have come up with another poem, and the title of the poem is Aunt Jennifer's Tigers. It is taken from the book Flamingo and it is being composed by Edwin Rich. So let us start with the line by line explanation of the poem. So first of all, let us do the reading of the poem. Aunt Jennifer's tigers prance across a screen, bright to pass denizens of a world of green. They do not fear the men beneath the tree. They pace in sleek, chivalric certainty. Now here, the poet is talking of Aunt Jennifer. Aunt Jennifer is such a character which I think which is every such woman who is dominated by the patriarchal society, that is the male dominated society. So Aunt Jennifer is one among all those many women. So the poet is actually talking about the pitiable condition of the women in a patriarchal society, and the name of that woman that the poet has taken up is Aunt Jennifer. Now the poet is saying that Aunt Jennifer's tigers prance across a screen. Now there is Aunt Jennifer who is embroidering some tigers, okay? And those tigers that she is embroidering, she says that the Aunt Jennifer's tigers prance across a screen. So there is a screen, or it can be a tablecloth, or it can be any piece of cloth on which she is embroidering the tigers, and the tigers are prancing across. Prance across, prance means jump. Prance means to jump. Okay, now the tigers, they are jumping. They are shown, they are embroidered in such a way on that screen or on that piece, particular piece of cloth, that it seems as if the tiger is jumping. Bright topaz denizens of a world of green. Now, topaz, the color of topaz is yellow. Topaz is a kind of a stone. Topaz is a kind of a stone, which is, what is the color of that stone? The color of that stone is yellow. Now the poet is saying bright topaz denizens of a world of green. Now here this particular word topaz is used for tigers. Topaz is used for tigers. We know that the skin color of tigers is black and yellow. Right? The skin color of tigers is black and yellow. More of yellow and less of black. So here that's why the poet has compared. A poet has talked of the tigers as bright topaz denizens. Denizens means those who live in the forest. Those who live in the green area. Those who live in the forest. Means those animals of the forest region. The animals of the forest are called denizens. Now again the poet is saying bright topaz denizens of a world of green. Now the tigers are called as topaz and they belong to the world of green. World of green means to the forest. They belong to the forest. World of green means they belong to the forest region. Now next line, they do not fear the men beneath the trees. Now they are talking of, the poet is talking of the qualities that the tigers have. We all know that the tigers, they are fearless, they are brave, they are courageous, isn't it? They are very chivalric, right? And they roam about in the whole of the jungle without any fear. They are so carefree, they are so free, and they are so independent, right? So they do not fear the men beneath the trees. So who are the men beneath the trees? The hunters. The hunters who are going to hunt them. So this now the poet is saying that the tigers, they are so free, they are so fearless that they do not even fear those men, those people who are sitting, who are hiding themselves beneath the trees in order to shoot them, in order to kill them. They are not even afraid of dying. They pace in sleek, chivalric certainty. Sleek means elegant. Sleek means elegant. Sleek means elegant. Very elegantly, very beautifully, they pace. Pace means they are moving. Pace means to move. So they are moving like very elegantly in the whole jungle, because tiger is called the king of the jungle. So just as a king moves in his kingdom, in his court, okay, in the same way, this whole forest is a kind of a kingdom, is a kind of a arena of the tiger, and the tiger is moving there with elegance. Very beautifully the tiger is moving. With a chivalric. Chivalric means, who all are chivalric? Chivalric are those who are very brave, who are known for being brave. So very bravely, very beautifully they are moving in the whole of the jungle without any fear of anybody. Now we come to the next stanza. Aunt Jennifer's fingers fluttering through her wool find even the ivory needle hard to pull. Now, through these two lines, the poet is trying to tell that Aunt Jennifer's, that particular lady, her fingers, they are fluttering. Fluttering means trembling. Flutter means to tremble. Now that the fingers of Aunt Jennifer, they are trembling through the wool. Wool means that particular material which she is using with the help of the needle. She is embroidering those tigers on a piece of cloth. So when she is using that wool, then her hands are shaking. Her hands are trembling. And she is even finding that very, very small, very, very light weighted needle also very hard to pull. Why? Because she has become very old, okay, and her hands are trembling. The massive weight of uncle's wedding band sits heavily upon Aunt Jennifer's hand. Now again the poet is talking of that particular man or that particular person to whom Aunt Jennifer was wedded with. The poet is saying that the massive means huge. Massive means huge. Now, although that wedding ring is a very, very small thing which is there on the finger of Aunt Jennifer, but still that wedding ring was quite weighty. She could not bear the weight of that wedding ring. Now, the weight of that massive weight of uncle's wedding ring also means this, that the uncle means the whom she was married with, the person with whom she was married with, was a very dominating kind of a person who dominated her, who did not let her lead her life freely, who did not let her lead her life independently. Okay, so now through these lines the poet is talking about the kind of the nature the Aunt Jennifer's husband was having. Aunt Jennifer was dominated very badly by her husband. And that's why she is saying that she could not bear the weight of the wedding ring. She was not at all happy. She was not at all contented. She was so dissatisfied with her husband. Okay, because he did not keep her nicely. Okay, all the time he was dominating her. Every now and then he was dominating her. So that's why, which was not liked by Aunt Jennifer, because she was having various desires in her heart. She wanted to live a life which was independent of anyone's dominance, but she could not lead her life in that particular way because her husband was very, very dominating, was very cruel, was very harsh to her, right? So now coming to the last stanza. When aunt is dead, her terrified hand will lie, still ringed with ordeals she was mastered by. Now, through these lines, the poet is saying that aunt will be dead. Okay, a time will definitely come. We are all mortals and we all die. We will be dying one day. So, the same the poet is saying that when aunt is dead, when aunt will die, okay, then what will happen? Her terrified hands, means those trembling hands who were always terrified, who were always fluttering while embroidering those tigers on the piece of cloth, they will lie without any movement, because when a person is dead, the body doesn't move. So they will lie as it is still, but still, even after her death, that particular ring which she is wearing in her hand, the wedding ring which was put by her husband on her finger, will still remain. Now, this is very important, this phrase, still ringed with ordeals. Ordeals means difficulties, troubles, problems, a difficult phase of life, obstacles that come in our life while we are moving on. So the poet says that when she will be lying dead, she will still be having that ring in her finger, which is actually a mark or a symbol of the problems that she had faced when she was married to that dominating personality, that dominating man whom she was mastered by. She was mastered by that man means she was dominated. Mastered by means dominated. Okay, she was dominated by that particular person. So that ring which will be there on her finger will be a mark or a symbol that how brutally that man kept this lady, Aunt Jennifer, and she was not at all happy with her married life. The tigers in the panel that she made will go on prancing proud and unafraid. Now, they're saying that although this lady is dead, although when the time will come of her death, she will die with the weight of that ring that she was wearing in her finger, but still, the tigers that she had embroidered, okay, it was her desire, it was her heart's desire that she wanted to lead a very fearless, a very independent life, okay, but she could not do so. But the way she had embroidered those tigers on that particular piece of cloth, they will always remain. Even after her death, they will always remain. And how will that, how will the tigers be? They will go on prancing proud and unafraid. And what kind of tigers they will be? The tigers will be very proud. Okay, the tigers will be not afraid of anybody. Not afraid of those shooters who might come from beneath the tree and might shoot them. Okay, they will be prancing. They will be jumping. They will be leading a fearless life. So let us begin with the figure of speech in this poem. First of all, in the last line of the very first stanza, you can see the repetition of the letter C here. So here we will say it is alliteration. Yes, chivalric certainty says it is alliteration. Now we come here to the very first line of the second stanza. We see there is repetition of the letter F. So again there is alliteration. Chivalric certainty, alliteration, figure fluttering, alliteration. Now coming to this line, the massive weight of uncle's wedding band, the repetition of W, the letter W, again alliteration. Okay, now if we come to this line, sits heavily upon Aunt Jennifer's hand, the repetition of the letter H, again in hand and heavily, the repetition of the letter H again goes for alliteration in this line. Then now we come to the last line, prancing and proud, there is repetition of the letter P, so again there is alliteration. Okay, so one more figure of speech is there in this poem. There is another figure of speech, that is world of green and bright topaz denizens. Bright topaz denizens and world of green, they are actually imagery. I-M-A-G-E-R-Y, imagery. The figure of speech here, bright topaz denizens, you can easily imagine in your mind a bright colored, bright yellow colored animal, that is the tiger, and a world of green. You can easily imagine a green forest which is full of vitality, which is full of spring, which is full of greenery. You can easily imagine that. So here the figure of speech is imagery, bright topaz denizens and a world of green. We come here to the her terrified hand. If you look at this, her terrified hand, there is transferred epithet. Her terrified hand, in her terrified hand we have another figure of speech that is called the transferred epithet. Once again students, if we look at this bright topaz denizens and secondly a world of green, if we look at these two, they have been used as a metaphor also. They have been metaphorically used. First, by using the word bright topaz denizens, the poet is talking about the tigers. Okay, and here when the poet is talking of a world of green, the poet is talking of the forest area. So we see that the bright topaz denizens as well as a world of green, it is used in two different types of figures of speech, as two different. First, as I have already told you, that is imagery, and the second that I am telling you now, that is metaphor. It has been metaphorically used here. Now again, if we come here, the weight of uncle's wedding ring. Weight of uncle's wedding ring. This is also used metaphorically. This is also metaphorically being used here. Weight of uncle's wedding ring. Okay. And this is all for the figure of speech from this Aunt Jennifer's tiger. And now let us see to the rhyme scheme of this poem, which is also very very important. In every poem, the rhyme scheme also holds a very important part, and you need to know what the rhyme scheme of a particular poem is, of particular stanza is. So let us find out the rhyme scheme. Let us look at the very first. Let us look at the very first, the last letter, the last word here, that is screen. Screen is matching with the last word of the second line, that is green. Screen and green, they are matching, so we will give it A. And because they are rhyming the same, so we will go give them both as A. Okay, so screen and green go as A. Now in the second line, we see tree and certainty. Tree and certainty. Tree is not matching with screen and green, okay, but tree and certainty, they are matching, right? They are rhyming, so that's why we will give it as B. So the rhyme scheme is A-A-B-B. Now let's come to the second. Wool and pull. So wool and pull, okay? So again, A and A, band and hand, B and B, lie and buy. Again, A. Then, made and unafraid. B. So, the rhyme scheme of this poem is A, B. This is the rhyme scheme of this poem. Students, while you will be answering the questions which will be related to this poem, so the important questions that can be asked, okay, they can be related to the second line, bright topaz denizens of a world of green. The questions can also be asked about Aunt Jennifer's fingers fluttering through her wool, that why were the fingers of Aunt Jennifer fluttering? Then you can very easily give the answer. If you have seen the whole video, very easily you will be able to answer this question, that she was dominated by her husband and she had grown very very old. That's why her hands were, the fingers were fluttering. Now again, a question can be asked to explain this particular line, the massive weight of uncle's wedding band. that why was the wedding band, which is not very, which is of a very light weight, how come that the poet is talking of, the poet is talking of the weight of that particular band as massive, as huge. So you can again easily explain this by now, sits heavily upon our, these two particular lines can be asked to explain, okay, because these are very very important lines. Now then here, these two lines, they are also very important. The tigers in the panel that she made will go on prancing proud and unafraid. So through this line, the poet can, a question can be raised about the desire of Aunt Jennifer. That how can you say that the desires of Aunt Jennifer will be fulfilled through the tigers? So they will be fulfilled because she was, through her hearts and hearts, she wanted to live a free life. She wanted to lead a fearless life as that of tigers. That's why she had embroidered those tigers on a, on the panel. And even when she drew it, she embroidered them because she knew that till she will be alive on this earth, she will not be able to lead a fearless life. She will always be mastered by her husband. Okay, she will always be dominated by her husband. But in her heart, the desire was to lead an independent life like that of a tiger, right? So that's why she had embroidered those beautiful tigers on a piece of cloth just to make her soul happy that at least she, whatever she thought in her lifetime, although she could not achieve that, but still when she will be dead, when she will be no more in this world, still the tigers which she had embroidered will be jumping here and there freely, fearlessly, chivalrically, right? On the green fields, in the green fields or in the forest region, right? I hope you all have understood this poem. And if you have understood this poem, then please share it with your friends, okay? Discuss it with your friends about this video. And those who are in the teaching fraternity, they can share it among their colleagues, right? And if you have any queries related to this this poem, any answer, any question that you are unable to answer, you can write to me. I will definitely come up to you and will provide you with the answers, okay? And if you have really liked my video, then please do not forget to subscribe my video, and please do not also forget to press the bell icon. Thank you. Future best was clash, but there's no